In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Brothers, sisters, friends, welcome to this celebration. We bless God for the gift of his constant love. And this will be revealed to us very clearly, it seems to me, both through his word today, and also as we gather around his table, some of us to receive, and also some of us to make a spiritual communion. Let these tokens and signs be a reminder to you of that which sustains indeed the whole creation and sustains each one of us as we journey on. Now, as we prepare for the gifts that the Lord has for us in this Mass, let us call to mind our need of his mercy and ask for forgiveness. Show mercy to us, loving Father. We have sinned against you. Please make us anew. In your love and your grace, you forgive us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Not on our failings, Lord Jesus. We have sinned against you. Please make us anew. By your life and your death, you redeem us. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Come fill our hearts, Holy Spirit. We have sinned against you. Please make us anew. Forgive us and heal us and save us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Amen. God, Without you, we are not able to please you. Mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. We ask our prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
And now, brothers and sisters, Angie and Tando will read to us from the letter of James.
A reading from the letter of James, chapter 2, verse 18 to 26. But someone will say, "You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without works, and I, by my works, will show you my faith. You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you senseless person, that faith without works is barren? Was not our ancestor Abraham justified by works when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was brought to completion by the works. Thus, the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. Likewise, was not Rahab the prostitute also justified by works when she welcomed the messengers and sent them out by another road? For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is also dead. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Can you remember where you were when you first heard the news? When you first saw what had happened? I can remember it vividly. I'd spent the summer in Oxford, and I'd just travelled back home to Leeds in the north of England, ready for the start of my second academic year as a lecturer at the university. I got off the train in the early afternoon and decided to head into the city centre to pick up some essential supplies. And the first thing I noticed was that the main pedestrianised shopping street through the centre of Leeds was, for that time of day, bizarrely quiet, except for a crowd of people gathered outside one particular shop, a branch of Dixon's, which sold domestic appliances, and its shop window was full of TV screens. I wondered what on earth was going on. So I went over and realized that the crowd was staring in stunned silence at the TV screens. And that's when I first saw what had happened on those TV screens. First, one hijacked passenger plane, then another, flying into the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center. There I was, 20 years ago yesterday, on the opposite side of the Atlantic, watching terror unfolding 5,000 kilometers away in New York. At that very same moment, the then Archbishop of Wales, Rowan Williams, was right there in Manhattan. He was at the Church of Holy Trinity, Wall Street, just a couple of blocks away from the World Trade Center. He'd planned to spend the day talking about religious language with a group of clergy and spiritual directors who had gathered from across the US. But instead, he found himself in the middle of a war zone, leading the group he was with in prayer before helping to lead them to safety, them and the young kids from a local kindergarten. As the towers collapsed around them. Within days of the attack, Rowan Williams wrote an article that offered a Christian response to the rage the world had witnessed. In it, he argued that, I quote, "the unspeakable tragedy of thousands of innocent dead cannot be made better by more death." And he added that the terrorist outrage may be humanly as unforgivable as it gets, but that is not the same as saying that revenge is what is needed. Now, in the confusion of those chaotic September days, his words didn't go down well with some politicians. But his fundamental point, which is surely right, was this, that God speaks a different language to the one we might expect. Not a language of revenge and retaliation, but a language of shared suffering and love. Rowan Williams explained, God chooses to speak a common language with us by sharing the experience of terror and death, and when we speak to God the language of hatred and rejection, God refuses to answer in that language. He can only speak his own word, which in the incarnation is a word shared with us. Twenty years after 9/11, it's good to be reminded that we have a choice about which language we speak when we're faced with hatred and rejection and violence and suffering. And today's gospel reminds us that God in Jesus Christ shares with us the experience of hatred and rejection and violence and suffering, and yet God doesn't turn, as politicians and those in power so frequently do, God doesn't turn to revenge and retaliation. Instead, God in Jesus Christ calls us to change our expectations and to see things differently. God in Jesus Christ shows us that there's another way to be, another way to live. The way of peace and justice and love. What we see in today's gospel is that Jesus turns upside down all our human expectations of where power lies and how it's exercised. And if you find that hard to grasp, then you're in good company. Just look at the first disciples, just look at Peter. Did you notice that in today's gospel, Jesus effectively asks the same question twice, or in two different ways? First, he asks his disciples the question, "Who do people say that I am?" And Jesus' disciples answer by reeling off a list of names, and they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others, Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." Jesus isn't fishing for compliments. He wants to know what the word is on the streets. What are people saying about him? Who do people think he is? And while the answers he gets might seem strange to us, they all point to the people's hope that a messianic prophet would emerge to lead the people of Israel out of political and spiritual bondage to the Roman Empire. For the people on the streets, Jesus is, if you like, the reincarnation of a great political and religious leader. Now, I think it's no coincidence that this exchange, right in the middle of the Gospel according to Mark, unfolds in a politically charged setting. We know that geography matters in Mark. My fellow deacon Jack made this point in his homily last week. Do you remember in the previous chapter of Mark from which we read last week, Jesus and his disciples traveled far outside Israel's boundaries, northwest from the Sea of Galilee and out into Gentile, non-Jewish territory, the kind of place where a good Jewish boy would never normally go. And there, precisely there, Jesus healed two Gentile, non-Jewish people. Today, Jesus and his disciples are back within Israel's boundaries, but they're traveling just about as far north of Jerusalem as you can get and still be within Israel. They're traveling, we're told at the beginning of the reading, they're traveling towards Caesarea Philippi, a crucial outpost of the Roman Empire. Developed by Herod the Great, and then by Herod's son, Philip, and named in honor of Caesar Augustus. It was a dazzling projection of the power and culture of the Roman Empire, the very empire to which Jesus' teaching is such a threat. So Jesus asked his question, "Who do people say that I am?" deliberately in the shadow of empire, with the presence of the Roman military and cultural power dominating the landscape and no doubt dominating the lives and the minds of the people all around. And that presumably explains the answers which the disciples report. The people were desperate for a savior, but a political savior, formed in their own image, not a savior in the image of the God who loved us enough to become one of us, who becomes one with us to affirm our humanity. So that's the response Jesus gets when he asks, "Who do people say that I am?" And then Jesus asks the question for a second time, but this time he doesn't ask what the people are saying. Instead, this time he asks his own disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And without hesitation, deviation, or repetition, Peter answers Jesus boldly and proclaims loudly and clearly for all to hear, and he's the first of the disciples to do this in Mark, "You are the Messiah." Literally, the anointed one of God. That's what Messiah means, the anointed one of God, the one sent by God to bring salvation and healing and hope and life eternal to a broken and sinful world. So far, so good. But you notice how just like the people wanting a political saviour, so Peter wants a Messiah on his own terms. In one breath, Peter declares Jesus' true identity as the Messiah, the anointed one of God, and in the next, he rebukes Jesus for saying that he must undergo suffering, rejection, and crucifixion. So yes, Peter gets the title right, but he doesn't seem to understand what the title means. And so when Jesus begins to talk not about the road to victory and glory, but instead about the road that leads to the cross, Peter rebukes him. And then Jesus rebukes Peter right back, even going so far as to call him Satan. It seems that Peter wants to be a disciple of Jesus, but on his own terms. He wants a strong, all-conquering God, powerful enough to throw the Romans out of Palestine, a divinely appointed bully to out-bully those he believed were bullying the people of God. But Jesus points to a very different God, not a Lion of Judah, but the Lamb of God, who meets us in vulnerability, suffering, and self-giving love. And this isn't what the disciples had bargained for in the Messiah, the anointed one of God. The King of Kings isn't supposed to suffer. Kings and queens of this world wear crowns of gold and silver, adorned with jewels. But Jesus will be given a crown of thorns, a crown that will pierce his skin, a crown that will cause blood to flow, blood that is shed for us, washing away our sins. Jesus' power is not like that of worldly rulers. He doesn't seek to defeat abuse, bullying, and terror with more of the same. This king is different. This king speaks a different language. This king insists that life isn't about winning, but about serving others. This king calls us to welcome the stranger, to feed the hungry, to love our enemies, yes, all of them. This king calls us to put aside our prejudices and our fears. This king calls for and offers compassion and forgiveness. This king, Jesus, subverts the whole idea that we should dedicate our lives to gaining power by manipulating and terrorizing others. Instead, he points to a new, paradoxical way of being, in which by denying ourselves and taking up our cross, we have life, and life in all its fullness. So Peter is able to identify Jesus as the Messiah, the anointed one of God, but his understanding of what this means turns out to be completely wrong, satanic even. Did you notice a little detail that Peter takes Jesus aside to rebuke him? But when Jesus rebukes Peter in return and tells him to view things differently, you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. When Jesus is saying that, the text specifically tells us that as he addressed Peter, Jesus turned and looked at his disciples. In other words, Jesus isn't just telling Peter to stop looking at things his own way. He's telling the other disciples there to stop looking at things their own way. He's telling us, you and me, to stop looking at things in our own way. He's confronting our assumptions about him. He's confronting our complacency, yours and mine. Jesus calls us to look at things differently, to look at things from his point of view, to look at things through his eyes, the eyes of compassion and forgiveness. 20 years on from 9/11, in this world where there is still so much violence and hatred and fear and oppression, we need to hear again and respond afresh to that call to see ourselves and the world in which we live through Jesus' eyes. In a world that still speaks of revenge and retaliation, Jesus speaks a different language. Jesus shows us a different way. The cross points us in a different direction. So as we come today to feed on the living bread, be it at this altar or in making a spiritual communion, let us open ourselves to being transformed into his image and likeness, to being shaped by the cross on which he died, so that through us, through our words and actions, as agents of God's grace, others might also come to know the God of extravagant mercy, who breaks down all the barriers that divide us, and whose perfect love casts out all fear.
Brothers and sisters, I invite you to join me in making the profession of faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken by the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now let us pray for the church and for the world, brothers and sisters, as Jesse leads us in our intercessions.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and commend it all into your hands. We thank you for the comforts and conveniences that you grant us each day, and ask that if by perchance these worldly comforts are taken from us, remind us that all things will indeed pass away, save for your unchanging love. We pray for the strength to face rejection and to be steadfast in faith when tested by those without faith. Let us not forget that in being denied for your sake, we are blessed. And also grant us the wisdom to know the things in this world that we cannot change, especially in this time of uncertainty. For the Church and her ministers, And in our Anglican Communion, we are bidden today to pray for the Anglican Church of Tanzania. And in our own land, we pray for the Diocese of Canberra and Goulburn. For our bishops and among the parishes of the diocese, we pray the parish of Roeville and Ferntree Gully. For our own parish, we pray, and all who look to Christ Church as their spiritual home. We look to the day that we may be able to gather again in the flesh for your own body and precious blood. We pray for the people of Brunswick and our local community, for families and households feeling under any pressure, for those who learn and those who teach, and especially the Sydney Road Community School, soon to have its home in our halls. As we give thanks for those who are working for good in the neighbourhood, we ask your blessing, Lord, on our new venture, the Lamb and Flag, that it may make a godly contribution to the life in Brunswick and be a living sign of your love. In particular, bless our Thursday lunch, which will be served from the Lamb and Flag for the first time this week. We entrust to all who are in need and among the sick, for Pam, Diane, Heather, Fiona, Ruth, Kevin, Lucy, Mary, Nola, Anna, Renee, Namal, and all who have asked our prayers at the icon of the Annunciation. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Among those who mourn, we pray your comfort and assurance for Stephen. We pray for the departed and ask that you look upon your faithful servants with mercy. Among the recent departed, we pray for the souls of Heinz Grobe and Marziale Devolio, giving thanks for their faith and friendship. We also remember those whose year's mine occurs today: William Ryan, Mary Allard, and Ross Jones. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. May they rest in peace and rise in glory. Finally, we pray for ourselves, that strengthened by our participation in this Mass, we may live well and please you in the week ahead. Thankful for the example of your saints through the ages, we ask your saints and angels to join in our prayers. And especially we ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, to pray for us as we say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for our sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All glory and honor be yours, always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Savior Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus Sabaoth. Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus Sabaoth. Plenis sunt caeli et terra,
merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, and we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Hosanna, Hosanna,
in excelsis.
Therefore, we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him.
Amen.
In the unity of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
All glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. And now, brothers and sisters, in company with the people of God everywhere, let us pray to the Father in the words our Saviour gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you,
but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Brothers and sisters, as is our custom, those who are in the church will receive the Blessed Sacrament, this little company, and I invite those of you with the reserve sacrament at home to communicate as well. And then I will pray the prayer of spiritual communion. Body of Christ, keeping eternal life. The body of Christ. 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 Now I invite those of you who are making a spiritual communion to pray with me. At your feet, O Jesus, I prostrate myself before you with an unworthy yet contrite heart, humbled yet longing to be in your Eucharistic presence. I love the gift of yourself offered to me in this great and blessed sacrament. Though unable to receive this food for my journey, I desire all the graces that this encounter with you can bring, and offer my heart afresh as a place where you might dwell, while I wait for the day when I shall again have the joy of sacramental communion. I trust in your desire to abide in me, and wish to possess you in spirit. Come to my heart, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for thee. Amen. And now let's have a time of stillness and reflection about the love that we have experienced in this Mass as our cantors sing.
Fear my heart. my strength. On you my heart is fixed with you. At my side, O Lord, whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you.
Let us pray. Keep, O Lord, your church with your perpetual mercy, and because without you our human frailty cannot but fall, keep us ever by your help from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable to our salvation. We ask our prayer through Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Just before the blessing, brothers and sisters, as always, it's a blessing to me and, of course, to the little company here to offer this worship with you. And we pray that the sense of the presence of the Lord will indeed be a gift to us all. That is the work of the Spirit, to draw Jesus near to us. And we can have a good hope that even in our Eucharist, even with us far apart, yet that Spirit unites us. The weeks go on and we wait to see what sort of relief will come for those of us in Melbourne anyway during the lockdown as the days and weeks go ahead. But I expect that for several weeks anyway, this will be the rhythm of our life. But keep that daily prayer, going, remembering and that lovely offertory hymn, the deep, deep love of Jesus. Jesus' mighty love for me. Thank you to the team who have participated in leading this worship today. And thank you to Deacon Russell for his homily. Now the blessing. God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and fill you with grace and with truth. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Let's go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Church with psalms must shout, no door can keep.